sure to subscribe to our channel. We publish new videos every day.
Program, our annual program of the Institute for Spiritual Culture. So first of all, welcome everyone and thank you for coming. Thank you for showing some interest in our topic of discover the glories of our mothers. For those of you who are attending our program for the first time, let me share a little bit of background information. So it is exactly 5 years ago that we inaugurated this little Institute for Spiritual Culture. It was also 2 days after the last Maha Abhishek, actually. I remember distinctly. And the inspiration for this Institute for Spiritual Culture I had because for the last 20 years I have been very much involved in the preaching in Bangladesh. And for those of you who are not so familiar with Bangladesh, it's actually not very far from here. It's just 1.5 hours drive and you come to the Bangladeshi border. And Bangladesh is a very unique place. It is East Bengal. It is the place where most of Mahaprabhu's associates come from, like Rupa Goswami, Sanatan Goswami, Pundarik Vidyanidhi, even Mahaprabhu's parents, Jagannath Mishra, Sachi Mata, they come from East Bengal, which is now Bangladesh. So many more, actually, even Madhavendra Puri, Mukunda Datta, Vasudev Datta, so many personalities come from that part of Bengal. And ironically, because it is a Muslim country, this actually has preserved our Vaishnav culture immensely, because the Muslims are not so fond of all the modern ideas. So that has kept our Vaishnav culture so alive. And, you know, over the last 20 years, I have been spending considerable time there, traveling with the devotees, preaching with them, living with them. When I'm there, I'm only with locals. There's no Western devotees living there. And over the last 20 years, I have received such transformational insights, actually, and which has deeply affected my personal spiritual practice, and of course also my preaching. And I could almost say my whole worldview was put upside down, actually, of how civilized, cultured human life is meant to be lived. And yeah, so I started thinking, you know, not everybody can go to Bangladesh. So that's why I felt the need for some systematic training and education in this topic of culture. And that's why I thought, all right, let me establish a little institute for spiritual culture. And I developed all kinds of courses, 6 courses actually. They quite naturally grew over the years. And for example, one course is on the Vanaprastha Ashram. There's nobody even talking much about it. Then one course about the need for sheltering relationships. One course about family life as an ashram, one course about child raising, one course about the man-woman dynamics, one course about the false ego, our constant companion and troublemaker. So many topics which are all very much connected with this topic of culture. So this little Institute of Spiritual Culture, it is basically an educational institution within the institution of ISKCON. Like last week, we had an international conference for education, and there are so many initiatives were presented. which are all directed towards one aspect of education. So, and in the same way, my humble attempt is to bring attention to this topic of culture. And since the last 5 years, since this inauguration, every year we have this annual program, which is like a symposium type program where I'm setting a theme and I'm inviting different speakers. And yes, just to bring attention to the importance of culture, because we can say our education at this point is often directed very much towards Shastric education. We like to learn our philosophy, memorize verses, preach them, repeat them. But that's step number one, according to my humble understanding. But the step number two is to actually live accordingly. That's a challenge. Yes, that's not so easy, actually. And especially these days, that materialistic propaganda which we are surrounded by is so strong, and the conditioning is so subtle and deep, it is not so easy to transform this, actually. And let me mention a few little points about culture. Let us first of all understand, how does culture develop? How does it come about? It actually comes about by practically living a certain worldview, a certain philosophy, a certain ideology. By practically living it, all different aspects of the culture develop in practical life. So, and there's only two main cultures in this world, materialistic culture, spiritual culture. And in Bhagavad Gita 2.69, Krishna says, what is day to the common person is night to the introspective sage, and vice versa. So that gives us some understanding that these two cultures are indeed like day and night, because they're based on very different worldviews. In a nutshell, materialistic culture is all about sense enjoyment and all about feeding the ego, actually, putting a lot of emphasis on bodily identification, gross and subtle. It's all about becoming an important, big, important person. That's what material life is all about, showing off. One can almost say, the more expert we become in showing off, the more successful one becomes in material life, right? And the media, Facebook, all these things, they're immensely helping in that endeavor to somehow become prominent and known and. But spiritual life is based on the opposite worldview. There we want to minimize and reduce sense gratification, and ultimately give up the taste for it, replace it with a higher taste. And we want to understand we are tiny, insignificant. We want to dissolve the subtle body and bodily concept of life. We want to dissolve the false ego. We become tiny, insignificant, humble servant. So these two worldviews are like day and night, actually. And we can imagine one end is the day of the materialist, other end is day of spiritualist. And in between is a broad spectrum of all kinds of mixtures and shades and grades. And spiritual life, devotional service, is actually meant to bring about this transformation, that the day of the materialist eventually becomes our night. That's actually what Krishna consciousness is meant to bring about. We are meant to transform our tastes, our likes and dislikes, our worldviews, our patterns of behaviors, our very heart. Otherwise, how can we develop bhakti in that heart, right? So, but this transformation cannot be imposed, enforced on people. It can only be inspired. Yes. everybody has to do that internal work at their own pace, and so on. And maybe not everybody even wants to transform. But in any case, I simply want to share these points to set a foundation to every further discussion, because even the topic of mother, we will hopefully get some insights in due course tonight, that in spiritual life and its culture, mothers play a super important role. They're very, very important. Mothers of all levels, as we know, Krishna gives us seven mothers. Whereas in material life, nobody even talks about the importance of mothers. This is not really a topic. Yeah, right? Except for Mother's Day. And even then, it's mainly a commercial interest. Let's be honest here. You know? Yeah, so much just as a little introduction. So I would just like to use the opportunity to share that even as a worldwide traveling preacher, I always try to keep this mood of mother also there. So no matter what roles we are actually playing, what service, we can execute that in the role of mother. And I want to share one little exchange I had with some of the boys in Bangladesh. Once, one brahmachari was saying to me, our Guru Maharaj is our father, and you are our mother, and mother more important. And I was a little surprised. I was saying, really? How is it? Mother more important than Guru Maharaj? And he gave a very nice answer. He put his hand on his heart and he said, yes, mother more affection. And that gave me the realization that actually if we women really deeply play this role of being mother, we can become so prominent in devotees' lives. Yes, that's the power of a mother, of a woman. The feminine energy, very powerful. And if we use it properly, we can leave such deep impressions and impacts on people's hearts and lives, even as a preacher, you know? Yes. And another thing also which I want to share, once one of our sannyasi gurus in ISKCON, Prabhupada, so I won't mention any names, but he shared with me privately, he was referring to one of his god sisters who left this world some years ago, and he said to me, she is my mother in Krishna consciousness. I don't go anywhere without remembering her. Yes, and that again confirmed for me deeply this understanding how important this mood and role of mother is. And mother, in my understanding, we can have some sutras type thing, that mother means she embodies the selfless mood of service. I am last, everybody else is first. Mother is not competing. Mother is not showing off. There's no room for, you know, sexual vibes or showing off. Then she's not mother. And she is this balancing and harmonizing force within the family or within the society at large, within the community. You know, so she has all these roles which are there on all levels. And if we ladies play that role in whatever service it may be, even as a leader, as a manager, as a temple president, as a preacher, whatever it may be. But if we try and execute it in that mood of mother, trying to make our men successful, let them get the credit, like a mother wants to see her son successful, you know, she's not competing with them. She wants to have them get the glory. So if we serve like that, that's very empowering for our men. And Prabhupada is saying, actually, women are meant to be the the power of inspiration, the auspicious source of energy to men, again, on all levels. So that's kind of, you know, how I understand this serving as mother, even as a preacher in the renounced stage of life. Okay, no need to clap. This was just some little sharing in between. Okay, so now we want to invite our next speaker, His Holiness Bhakti Vidya Purna Swami, and he will more deeply unpack the same topic of these three mothers, of the wife of the brahmana, the wife of the king or leader, manager, and wife of guru. So please, Maharaj, share your words of wisdom with us.
And so then they teach knowledge. And so one has a debt to them. Then in the family, we see that the mother and father there, they take care of us from when we're, you know, when we're unable to take care. And from that we have a debt. So in this, the effort that's put in by the between the mother and father, the mother then, Mana mentions the debt is 10 times that of the father. Because the effort, the different things that they do, that we see the fathers, you know, they're busy doing other things. So, then he goes on to say that the teacher then is equal to the father. But he also mentions that the teacher who gives spiritual knowledge, that's equal to the mother. Because that actually brings up the, how you say, the real purpose. Because the point is that the whole system that we're talking about, the whole culture that's there, is all meant to try to become God conscious. Because the whatever goes on here then will be the reflection of the spiritual world. So the spiritual world then is where things are eternal. Because here's the principle will be seen. You'll have mother, you'll have father, you have other relations and all that. But the potency of that is coming through the universal form. Because you see, as we're taking, you know, earth, water, fire, air, and ether, and then it's acting as mother. Same soul in another body of earth, water, fire, air, and ether acts as father or brother or sister or, right? So there's a potency that's there, the Lord, because these relationships come from Him. He's rasa. So the five rasas come from Him. So many times we'll talk about, you know, Mother just showed us in, you know, parental rasa, or the gopis there in the conjugal rasa, the cowherd boys like this, but you don't hear about what rasa is Krishna in, right? Because he's not in a rasa, he is rasa. So then when he arranges for the living entities to come to the material world, then he expands to make everything work. He's the one that makes it all function. So we see in the instructions that Krishna is giving to the gopis when they first come, at the rasa dance, when he meets them after the rasa dance, when he sends Uddhava, then he's always pointing out that he is everything and everything is him. And so one can look at that from that principle of just, okay, he's God, he's doing all this. But the point that he's bringing out to the devotees is that it's because of his affection he's doing this. So these are all five different kinds of affection that are there that are coming from Krishna. Right? So that's the actual basis on why these positions are appreciated and respected, because they represent Krishna. Right? So Krishna's taking care of everything. He's in the heart, he makes everything function. You want something to happen, it does. Right? And as Mataji pointed out, do you see Krishna involved in this? No, he's in the background. He points out in the 11th canto that he himself likes the indirect aspect, where he's brought out, but brought out from that indirect. He appreciates that. So this aspect pleases him. That's why you see as it goes up, then these parental rasas and these other things, because they're more hidden, they're more appreciated. So the Vedic concept is that the position of mother is respected because of the representation of the Lord. Now, the particular individual who's taking up that responsibility, then they are respected for doing that. Because for Krishna, it's all personal. Because we can say, oh, but they're not actually doing it, Krishna's doing it. But then if we look at that, then we're not doing anything. Krishna's doing everything. But the point is, for Krishna, it's the interaction that's important. It's not what energy is moving what that's there. Just as long as you understand that it all goes back to him. So that appreciation then becomes very important. Because if on these finer levels you can't appreciate the position of mother, then basically no other relationships will really come to the forefront. If they do, then that's nice. Then through that, then one can expand. But you can see it's the natural position, because from the mother, you know the father, you know the teacher, you know those other siblings, you know everything else from there. Being the first guru, everything expands from there. So this position that is there, it has this aspect. So we can appreciate, but at the same time is then those who are in the position, they also have that way they can be God conscious. Because it's not that, okay, they're just the mother. But the position comes up as they're representing that potency in the Lord, because mother means what's the principle is that nourishment. So the mother specifically is responsible to see to the physical and emotional nourishment. But you see in the devotee field also then the spiritual is coming up. So for Krishna then this aspect of cultivating Krishna consciousness, this then becomes very important. And if, So we see with the example that the gopis give, after Krishna tells them that, you know, you've come, it's very nice, you came out, saw the evening, the moon is very nice tonight, you know, the weather is very good, you came out for your stroll in the forest, but now that you've seen everything, now it's time to go back home. So they point out is that their family members, that they're there, they're involved, but how they're able to function is that they're seeing them all as connected to Krishna. That the motherness is there, the fatherness, the childrenness, well, all these things, this is all Krishna. Because he's what makes it function. That's why the experience is the same. Doesn't matter what place, what time, or what community, what culture, the experience between the parent and child and all that, it's the same. Right? Even go into the animal kingdom, it's the same. Because it's Krishna that's pervading. He's creating this. Because otherwise, how does dead matter, you know, decide that, okay, you know, it's like, how, you know, this chair and that chair, what's the relationship? Right? So Krishna empowers, so it works, then it has that flavor. And because it's Krishna, therefore it must be respected. That's the whole point. So they're seeing Krishna in whatever they're doing. So they're at their house, they you know, in those situations, they're married, there's so many children in the house, other co-wives, all these other things, mothers-in-laws, all these other aspects. Yeah, notice in the seven mothers. Okay. So that aspect then is being brought out that they're seeing Krishna. And that's the thing, it reminds them of Krishna. So much of the time it comes up as that, okay, we're spiritual, Or we get sentimental. Right? And sometimes we see never the twain shall meet. Right? It's one or the other. And, you know, they'll be opposed to each other, and this has been going on since time immemorial. But the point is that one can be Krishna conscious and at the same time the culture is followed, because that's what Krishna expects. He's God, he's controlling everything, he is everything, but he follows the culture and interacts. That's where the taste is. The taste is in the interaction. It's not in the position, the power, the authority. Because Krishna has that. He doesn't have to compete. So for him, that interaction with the devotees, based on whatever position they see him in, that's what's the attractive aspect. So therefore, one can follow all the principles that are given in the Varnashram, all the cultural aspects very nicely, and be fully God-conscious. The gopis are doing it, right? And we wouldn't say that their house is necessarily the most ideal, right? They have relatives that aren't really very impressed with their affection for Krishna. But within that, they're able to always see Krishna. So they're always being able to be absorbed. So that thing is, the Vedic is always this balance. It's not political, it's not economic, it's not about what you're going to gain, it's not about getting free of the material world, it's about remembering Krishna. And if you do that, everything else comes. So much of the time it's misunderstood that bhakti means, okay, we detach from everything, or bhakti means we can engage everything. No, bhakti means you remember Krishna. That's bhakti. And so in doing that, as one matures and one starts to see the value of the relationships, how those relationships, why are they valuable? Because they come from Krishna. Then appreciating that, then one is able to see Krishna, and the culture naturally comes along. Bhakti includes the culture. Prabhupada said, philosophy without religion is mental speculation. And religion without philosophy is sentiment. Right? So we see it goes way back. Because the religion is the practical application of the philosophy. So they have to match. But because Krishna, he is everything. It's about pleasing him. He gives the culture. Right? We don't create the culture. So if we're remembering him, then the mediums through which that remembrance goes on nicely, then it's given by him. We follow that, it works. It is balanced. We may not see the logic of it and this and that, but it is balanced. Why? Because we're dealing with this with the Lord. We're dealing with unlimited. So the fine points and all these things. So it's a matter of revelation. Krishna being beyond logic, then it's not a matter of us understanding through logic. It's us by surrender he reveals. Right? That's why we use the term realization. Realization means there's that surrender, and then from that application, then we get an understanding. Otherwise, no. So we have to appreciate that Krishna being the central feature. All relationships are based on that. As Lord Chaitanya was saying in Chaitanya Charitamrita, that sambandha means that Krishna is the center of all relationships. Right? Abhideya means all activities are meant to please Krishna. That means all these relationships, all these interactions, all the culture is meant to please Krishna. And all goals are for that pleasure of Krishna. So if that's kept in mind, then we see these two can run together. Because Krishna is non-dual, so he doesn't have a problem in both things happening at once. Everything is him, but everything's different from him. And for him, that's not a problem. Right? But as soon as we say it's this or that, then it immediately drops to the political platform. It's no longer spiritual. Right? Because the two go together. So the philosophy, the culture, they go together. We see the devotees are very nice, they're very comfortable, very well-behaved. That's because it's all about Krishna. So naturally all the good qualities come when we surrender to Krishna and follow according to that. Then we'll see is that these relationships are appreciating the position of mother. It's not either a sentiment or something, oh, we're detached, we don't get involved in that. It's a matter of the position is Krishna. The potency is Krishna. We appreciate that. We're respecting that. So when it says that the devotee respects all living entities, it means that's literal. That's not just a nice poetic thing just to say we're nice guys. It means whatever is happening in every position, that's Krishna. And if one can do that, then one will find one can always be Krishna conscious, and at the same time, one finds that all interactions, all positions, all relationships, they all go very nicely. With that. Sorry. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Thank you very much, Maharaj. Let me see, is there any question for Maharaj? Do we have any paper or something? Otherwise, one question comes to my mind, that the wife of Guru, Brahmana and king or leader, how can in the modern days of ISKCON, how can the wife play that role of mother? Can you elaborate a little bit on that? How it could, just for us ladies to understand how to actually cultivate that mood and how to practically manifest it.
Mm. Yeah, it means, in other words, it's understanding what we're working with. Because the particular bodies we have, they're tools. And as we see, as Prabhupada explained the karma, the one in the female body is the man who remembered the wife at death, and the one who's in the male body is the woman who remembered the husband at death. Like that. So it just keeps changing every life like that. Or it may go on for a few lives. The Hindus talk about, how you say in the marriage vows, being married for 7 lifetimes. So, it seems that that's the maximum you can get out of it. At some point, it's going to switch. But they haven't said necessarily who's who in the next marriage like that. They generally take it that, but whatever. No one's asking either. So we have two aspects that are going on here. See, means Krishna is the primary element, right? So he's the controller of the Icha Shakti. So Icha means desire. So it's about his desire. Everything's functioning on that. Now, for that desire to be manifest, then it's about, so in his desire, that manifests the devotees, the dham, the pastimes, all these different aspects. But for that to happen, then there's the Kriya and Jnana Shaktis which support that. So then this aspect of the Kriya and Jnana, they take care of the facilities, the particular relationships, the mechanics of what goes on. So if you want to do something, it's about the relationship, but there's mechanical elements that are done to make it happen. So those mechanical elements are for expressing the main aspect of the relationship. So if that's appreciated, then one can see what's happening in the dham. So because it's about Krishna, you don't really have to make a distinction between what's going on in the spiritual world. But you can. Like Mother Jashoda, then her rati, or her attraction to Krishna, is the parental rasa. So that's her affection for Krishna. That's the primary aspect. The secondary is she manifests that through the activities of cooking for Krishna, arranging for his clothes, his bath, his, all these other aspects. Right? But those only have value because they manifest her affection. Right? So we see that there's two things that happen at once. There's the main thing, the primary and secondary there. That's reflected into the material world. So because Krishna being everything coming from him, it will have the same nature. So in the material world, even though it's all secondary, because it's not about Krishna, but you can still find primary and secondary within it. Right? So then in this case, then we're looking at the relationships and that experience that's there. That's the primary aspect. The secondary aspect is the mechanical things that are done to express that. So if it's appreciated and understood, then masculine nature tends to focus on the mechanical aspect. Feminine nature tends to focus on the experiential aspect. If the mechanics are perfect, the man's happy. But if the mechanics are perfect, but the experience isn't good, the women won't be happy. So the experience has to be proper, even if the mechanics aren't great. So that's why sometimes it's not really understood. You see, women can do things so expertly, mechanically, or not. Because the point is whatever creates the experience is all that's necessary. So if technical is necessary to get the experience, technical will be done. But if it's not, it won't. But for the men, they'll tend to always do it mechanically perfectly. That's at least they'll try for. So in all these positions, then you'll see is that bringing out to see that that personal element's not lost in the mechanics. That's the main thing that we see is the feminine element brings into this. Because it's like, what do you call it? Seeing the can't see the forest for the trees kind of thing. Is that men will get into sometimes so much detail they forget, you know, what it's about. You know, you're managing the festival, trying to make it so perfect and everything exact and the timing and all that, that you're not really worried about the devotees or the people, the experience. And so then the wife brings these things up. Like that. And so that's that aspect. Then that's what balances. So when we say balance, it means it's balancing something else that's already there. Because you can only have a balance if the two have the same kind of, have some equal power. So it's different kinds of power. This idea is that equality means same power, then you're dealing with the same thing. Right? It's just like, okay, we have that chair over there. Okay, we have a relationship. What's your relationship with that chair? Right? Because it's exactly the same chair. And that one over there, and that one over there. There's no uniqueness. So we have to understand is that Krishna is unique. His potencies are unique. As they expand, they're all unique. And they have this masculine and feminine aspect. One has to know what is what, because we're the soul. We're not the body. We're not the men. We're not the women. As soon as we start talking, we're the men, we're the women, we've actually lost the plot. Plot is we're devotees. And we work through this. Does this make sense? To give a simple example, if I'm cooking potatoes, it's not about me, I'm the big controller of the vegetables. It's about I deal with potatoes as you can deal with potatoes. And that's going to be different than if I have a pile of spinach. Does that make sense? So you deal according to the nature that's there. So it's a big science, because Krishna is a Shakti, Shaktiman, and then there's the Shakti, how these two interact. And you see when you're dealing on rasa, then the feminine nature is the powerful one. If you're dealing mechanics, then because men can deal in mechanics with zero emotion, it won't function very well for women. So the women have to bring back that. The whole point is yes, the mechanics are perfect, but they have to be subservient to that experiential aspect. Right? Because we say it's a culture of Krishna consciousness, not it's a perfect mechanics of Krishna consciousness. Right? So that always has to be seen, and if that science is seen, then you know where the power is. Otherwise, we'll fight over mechanics. We won't fight over experiential. Right? So that's the problem. We miss the point. Is that okay?
Yes. And I have another nice question. Okay. We are told to see any woman besides our wife as mother. How can we practically have this vision?
Well, I think there's this old... it was kind of like a... I think this song was by a comedian, maybe back from the maybe 60s. He was talking about being nice to, I think it was basically was talking about being nice to birds and all that, because that bird that you're harassing might be someone's mother. Yes. So the whole point is that's the potential. Manu mentions that men are, it means, you know, boys are born to become fathers and girls are born to become mothers. So that's the potency, that's the principle that's there. someone steps out of that and functions in the aspect of renunciation, then that's fine. That's because it's for the spiritual purpose. But the principle is that the potency is that of mother. It's the same activities, the same elements of nourishment and all that. Because if that's seen, then that's a strong position. Then one deals properly. Because if you see as mother, then you put in a senior position. But if you don't see in that way, then that can put it... If it's in a junior position, okay, as daughter, then it'll still have the parental rasa. But if you don't, you put it as equal. Equal means conjugal. Kingskul means sense gratification. So especially in the modern contemporary environment, it's always trying to be that the feeling is that of equal, but that always brings out the sexual aspect. So as soon as you put it that it's senior or junior, then you get rid of that. But we see the recommendation in the Vedic is senior. Right? That's the position. And it's a matter of culture. I've seen it myself. I remember when you would have been 70, maybe 74. We were going around, and many times you do programs. You're in somebody's house. I think these programs. I was in maybe we're in Bombay or in South India, either Bangalore or Madras. And at some point in the program, we're taking prasad. And much of the time, you will see, just like it mentions in the Bhagavatam, Subhadra Devi wasn't married, so to increase her piety, then to give fortune to her life, then her seniors then see to that. Rendering of service to the sadhus, the guests, like that. And so then when Arjuna came disguised as a sannyasi, then she was the one serving prasad. And so then she's dealing in all the nice ways and this and that. And so then that principle, I can remember being at the houses in that time, then we would have been like 19 years old or something. And so then... But the girls that were serving us may have been that age or even younger. They would have been in their teens, so they would have been more trained. But the mood in which they would serve the prasad and deal in that was exactly no different than the elder ladies who were dealing. So it was exactly as mother. So it's that you're feeding, you want to see, and all this and that. So it was never seen as a trouble. So the relationship is able to be expressed through that. So one just naturally deals in that way. So the point of, I would say, that is an important element to regulate it is, generally we take it that we're expressing the mother means we're expressing the sense of possession, but that doesn't work unless you have everything else that goes with it. It's more the aspect of that nourishment, that aspect of it, that care for just that things are going to work out properly, that aspect. Because I've seen a lot of times girls will try to bring that thing of mother and they immediately just put the thing of possession. And that won't work unless that's a cultivated relationship. Right? If it is, then it naturally comes. But they have to take that. That's why the shelter and the other aspects, they have that possession in other elements, with their father, with the husband, with the son, with other relatives, with somebody. And so then that's there, that's focused there. Then with others, you can just deal in that very pleasant, balanced way. But if you try to project this sense of possession on someone that you don't have that, then you don't get the right reaction. Does that make sense? Like I was saying, these girls are there, there's no sense of possession, it's just you're a guest, they're serving, this is the proper way to serve. So they're not trying to control like that. And also an interesting thing in the marriage ceremony, in Satkriya Sardipika, in the Panigrahana, is it Panigrahana? Yeah, I think so. There's 10 like blessings the husband's giving for the wife, well wishing and all that. And one of them is Always I found it interesting once. May you be the controller of my mother. May you be the controller of my father. This is the groom is saying. May you be the controller of my sisters and brothers and others. May you control the whole thing. So, but it's not about control by mechanics. It's control by the qualities, the interaction, the endearing element that you control everybody. That's the control. You know, does that make sense? So, you know, we're not talking about, the Tomb Raider control, like that, yeah.
Yes, I mean, even in the family unit, we can say the father is the official family head. But yeah. Who runs the show? It's the mother. And not by telling everybody what to do, but through her service, through her selflessness. She controls and ties up everybody's hat. Hmm. And that's how she runs things. And in the same way also in the larger family of an ISKCON community, that's how we women can run the show, actually, through our selfless service and devotion.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, thank you so much, Maharaj. It was very nice. Thank you. If I may add a couple of little things which I learned in Bangladesh in regards to seeing every woman as mother, because this role of mother is so important, that's why the young girls are trained in this role of serving in the mood of mother. And that's why even young girls by their own father are called ma, mother. So a father will address his two-year-old daughter as mother. Yes, yes. I mean, that was quite eye-opening for me. And when we hear this, we often think mother has to be older because we think on the bodily platform, you know, how can we call somebody mother who is younger? But no, to help us create this vision of seeing every woman as mother, and also for the men that they can cultivate this mood of seeing every woman as mother, that's why in spiritual culture we usually address women as mothers, because that will help us to have that, cultivate that vision that everybody is mother. And simply, yeah, I find it very interesting that already young girls, they're called mother, so that they very naturally grow into this role of serving in the mood of mother. Not meaning that she has to be physically a mother, but with that mood of mother, nurturing, balancing, harmonizing, and. Okay.
Do you like our ad-free videos? Be sure to subscribe to our channel. We publish new videos every day, and don't forget to like and share our channel.